Good evening. Delta's stranglehold is tonight tightening on Victoria. Nearly 1,500 cases, our worst day yet, is forcing contact tracing to change as a political blame game erupts over the bill to support the construction shutdown. State political reporter Mark Santomartino.
Melbourne's trapped in a fog of rolling numbers that are only getting worse.
We keep doing that, these numbers will go from 1,500 to 2,000 and beyond.
Grand final gatherings fuelling today's 1,488 infections, 50 higher than Thursday's spike, setting a record that dwarves anything Victoria faced in last year's second wave.
It's another challenging day, the highest numbers of daily COVID cases we have seen and the largest numbers of active cases at any one time we've seen in Victoria. The estimate we've got is around a third of what we're seeing has been driven by a significant upswing in social gatherings that we saw last weekend.
More than 1,000 of today's cases are in the city's west and north, overshadowing a surge in the southeast, and another 71 cases in the regions, including 10 at Shepparton.
That includes a case involving a grand final party with 17 other people.
A risk that plunged the regional city back into lockdown at midnight on 5 hours' notice. Almost 50% of Shepparton is fully vaccinated, narrowly behind the state average, making way for a rethink in isolating supermarket staff.
We've seen some, but we've seen next to no transmission between staff and customers in supermarkets.
In a new trial, quarantine for exposed workers will be cut from 14 to 5 days or even a negative test if staff are fully vaccinated, wearing masks and cleaning is up to code.
It's not a free kick. It encourages good behaviour.
Lightening the load on contact tracers, dealing with 50,000 close contacts waiting to exit isolation.
You will not receive a follow-up phone call from the Department of Health. You will not receive any follow-up communication from us. That negative test result from your day 13 test will be sufficient to release you.
Those arriving from interstate should expect the same treatment as Victoria prepares to reopen the borders and reopen construction, waving cash at the 70,000 businesses it forced to shut down, offering one-off payments of $2,000 to $8,500 worth $196 million.
The construction grants would have been doubled if the Commonwealth government had not refused to contribute.
Treasurer Tim Pallas accusing Scott Morrison of being the Prime Minister for Sydney.
It's blatant favourable treatment for New South Wales. This is churlishness, this is mean-spirited behaviour, and it hurts an industry that doesn't deserve this treatment.
Victoria has received per capita the highest amount of support of any state or territory throughout this pandemic.
Spin that matters little to the families of another two infected Victorians who died. Both are in their 60s. Just 5% of the now 429 Victorians in hospital are fully vaccinated. 97 are getting intensive care. 54 need machines to breathe.
Genuinely, we really need people to recognise that this is a very perilous path that we're on, and we're, what, 4 or 5 weeks away from 80% double dose. It is not an impossible distance.
And Mark, the Federal Treasurer has swiped back at Tim Pallas.
Well, after being accused of being from but not for Victoria, Alicia, Josh Frydenberg has released his own statement undermining some of the numbers that Tim Pallas quoted today. It reads in part that the Morrison government since the pandemic began has delivered more economic support to Victoria on a per capita basis than to any other state. In total, $50.2 billion out the door. Each state has been responsible for designing their own business support program. Now, the reason why construction wasn't included in Victoria's program, Alicia, is because they expected to keep the sector open. Obviously, that's changed, but it's a technicality that the Commonwealth is sticking to, a stance that Tim Pallas says, given the changing situation, makes no sense.
All right, Mark Santomartino, thank you. Well, police have wasted no time in arresting anti-lockdown protesters who took to Melbourne streets for a third consecutive weekend. As Maggie Rayworth reports, much of today's anger was a result of vaccines becoming mandatory for all essential workers.
Police swooped, swiftly plucking protesters from the pack. More arrests followed. The public order response team wasted no time moving in on anti-lockdown protesters.
Relax.
Demonstrators initially planned to gather at the Shrine of Remembrance, but a strong wall of authority deterred the crowd. Poorly organised protesters could be heard struggling to round up numbers for their rally. They formed a group at the Botanic Gardens.
You should be ashamed of yourself!
But they were heavily outnumbered. Hands on pepper spray, police eager to shut this down. Officers were out in force.
Move on, you're getting a ticket in the mail. mail, all right?
Those against mandatory vaccines and lockdowns making their voices heard. All workers on the authorised list must have one dose of a COVID-19 vaccine by October 15. Anti-vaxxers say the measure has pushed them out of work.
Lost my job because I'm not vaccinated. We are losing our freedom of choice.
Protesters made their way through the city, shouting their demands before police shut it down.
Freedom! Police came from behind. We saw them coming.
Protesters say they'll continue to rally until all their demands are met, many stating they're prepared to be arrested for their cause.
Why, really? I mean, we get it. So we get the fact that people are frustrated, we get the fact they're upset. You're not helping yourself, you're not helping anybody.
Alicia, police made several arrests this afternoon. We know there were between 200 and 300 protesters here at the TAN earlier today. They were heavily outnumbered by police, though. They were able to shut down today's rally super quickly. Now, we know protesters are becoming increasingly fatigued. We are seeing less of them turning out to these rallies. But ultimately, Alicia, the protesters today, they were far less aggressive and far less violent than what we've seen in recent weeks.
All right, Maggie Raworth there. Thank you. Well, thousands of Melburnians are now rolling up their sleeves at local schools and football ovals that have been transformed into pop-up clinics. It's the latest strategy by the government to help meet its vaccination targets. Mimi Becker has the story.
The footy season may be over, but in the race to vaccinate, the state is hitting its stride. Witten Oval, now home to Victoria's newest vaccination hub.
The idea was to use this venue and use the great people around here and give support, supply and support for people as the numbers grew.
More than 2,000 Western Suburbs residents are expected to roll up their sleeves this weekend, with Commonwealth GPs and state staff working together to administer vaccines.
Best is at its best when we work together, and today is a great example of that.
In the north, Glenroy College is one of three new school-based pop-up clinics.
And these are good opportunities for people who live locally to come and get vaccinated close to your home.
It's easier for everybody. It's good. Yeah, so quick, yeah.
1,000 doses set to be administered to the local school community this weekend.
This is a great opportunity to bring it to the local community, and people are turning out in their hundreds.
I was meant to be done in 2 weeks' time, but I brought it forward.
70 school sites have been earmarked as part of the program's expansion.
It allows all of our families and students to be able to have access to the vaccine when they would not otherwise have it.
You can still get your vaccine at one of the major state-run hubs. Over the next 7 days, there are more than 57,000 appointments available, including close to 19,000 first doses of Moderna, 8,600 doses of Pfizer, and nearly 8,000 first doses of AstraZeneca.
You can log in and put your name against any of those 57,000 slots today.
Commonwealth data shows 91,450 doses have been added to the state's tally. More than 81% of Victorians aged over 16 have had their first dose, while 51% are fully vaccinated. Mimi Becker, Nine News.